Welcome back to Morning Joe. Live pictures at 3:53 in the afternoon at the Kabul airport in Afghanistan on the eve of America's evacuation and withdrawal after nearly 20 years of war there. The United States military is working to evacuate hundreds of Americans still looking to leave the country before tomorrow's deadline set by President Biden. According to the latest numbers provided by the State Department, approximately 250 U.S. citizens are still in Afghanistan. Since August 14th, the United States says it has evacuated more than 122,000 people, including more than 1,200 since yesterday morning. As for the thousands of Afghans who worked with the U.S. military who have not yet been evacuated, the New York Times reports their window to be airlifted has closed. The Times says a text message was sent out late Saturday, which read in part, quote, "We regret to inform you that international military evacuations from Kabul airport have ended." Joining us now, NBC News Chief Foreign Correspondent Richard Engel from Doha, Qatar. Richard, good morning. What is your sense on the eve of this withdrawal of how many people, how many Americans, how many Afghans who want to get out remain at the airport trying to leave the country?
Well, this has been a violent race to the exit, and it is getting more and more dangerous, more and more chaotic in this last phase. We are less than 24 hours to go. And this morning there was a rocket attack on the airbase being blamed on ISIS. The U.S. is coordinating with the Taliban. The U.S. and the Taliban in coordination are trying to prevent ISIS from disrupting this process. The U.S. has now conducted two strikes against ISIS, including one in Kabul. And the Taliban are saying that the Kabul missed its target and hit and killed a family. So as these evacuations, as evacuees are trying, hoping to get on one of these last flights, the Americans are saying, sorry, it's over, the window is closed, and they're conducting this mini drone and car bomb and rocket war with ISIS right in the 11th hour. So you have a tremendously complicated situation with the U.S. trying to pull out safely, trying to guard the perimeter, and then these last Americans, like the ones who got those text messages saying, you're just going to have to wait it out. We're done. The gates are closed. Those inevitably going to be left behind, or who feel that they had a good reason to leave, that they didn't get a chance to make their case, they didn't have the appropriate paperwork, are now going to face potentially a long wait. They're going to have to wait until they get their documents, until the civilian airport opens, or they could potentially make their way to one of the land borders up toward Central Asia, Iran, or Pakistan. And it's not clear when the airport is going to open. There were some talks that the airport was going to open in coordination with the Qataris and with the Turks. It could take weeks for that to happen. Could be less, but there's been a significant amount of damage at the airport itself, and the pilots are simply not going to fly if they don't have the right reassurances. So we're racing toward the exit. It's a violent race to the exit. People are going to be left behind, and they're going to be very very stressed, to put it lightly. But the Taliban is saying that is not hunting anyone down, that is not going to bother people, that it will allow people to leave. And then the question is, can they be trusted? Can they be taken at their word?
Well, yeah, that's the big question, Richard. You've covered this war for 20 years. You've covered the Taliban very closely. You've been in among them. They've said the right things, like a PR effort for the last couple of weeks. But the sense from people I talk to is they're saying the right things until that last American plane lifts off, and then it's back to their usual medieval business. So what is your sense of what Afghanistan will look like on Wednesday?
Well, the Taliban are being nudged by many different actors, Qatar among them, but not only. And they are being nudged in the right direction. They are saying to the Taliban, you can't go right back to the way you were. The people won't accept it. You're going to face an insurgency. You're going to be ostracized by the international community. You will be hated. You don't want to do this. And there are many in the senior Taliban leadership who agree with this, who want to try and have a fresh start, want to have Taliban light, if you will, where they still control the basic tenets of society based on a strict form of Sharia, but not anything like the rule that they had in the 90s. So a lot of it will also depend on how the world reacts to the Taliban. If the world tries to encourage them along, tries to bring them out, maybe it could help. If the U.S. suddenly slaps sanctions on them, they could have a negative reaction, retrench and retract. And so the Taliban are trying to explore this new territory. They are saying the right things, and they're saying the right things for a reason, because people around them are telling them to say the right things. Some of them believe this. They do want to try differently. They do want to not antagonize an entire new generation of Afghans. But I think a lot of this will depend on how the world reacts. Are they going to be embraced? Will they suddenly get hit by sanctions? Will events on the ground overtake them? Will there be more airstrikes against them? So I think, talking to them, that there are enough in the senior leadership that they do want to give it a try. But the question is, what is their version of giving it a try, and how receptive is the world going to be to a new and claimingly rebranded Taliban?
Hey, thanks so much for watching our YouTube channel. You can follow up on today's top stories and breaking news, or catch up on your favorite MSNBC shows all in one place. Download the NBC News app today.